Hi, I'm Susan Wingrove-Reed. I am the principal keyboard player in the symphony and the education consultant for our orchestra. And we're going to talk a little bit about five different composers who will be featured on the upcoming symphony concert, American Voices. And the program, an exciting one, every single piece is so cool in very different ways. Our concert opens with a work by a young Latino composer whose name is Carlos Simon, and it's a piece called The Block. And Carlos is, well, he was born in 1986, so he's pretty young, and he just started a composer residency at the Kennedy Center, where he's also working on an opera that will be premiered this year. So he is up and coming. He's done commissions for the LA Phil, Detroit, oh, so many major orchestras. And we are thrilled to discover him for the first time on an Anchorage Symphony concert stage. The Block combines jazz and gospel and neo-romanticism in terms of its style of writing. And Simon's mission, he described in an interview, as telling the stories of people who often aren't heard, is related to the fact that he was inspired to create this piece, The Block, based on six different paintings or scenes of a block in Harlem, and related to an artist whose name was Ramar Bearden, who was born in Charlotte and then moved to New York for the majority of his life. He was a great watercolor, graphite, metallics, collages, all kinds of interesting art. And he was a founding member of a group called The Spiral, which had a focus on African-American artists in the civil rights movement. He was also a songwriter, and he wrote a tune called Sea Breeze, which was a huge hit all across America, and recorded with Dizzy Gillespie. He was the National Medal of Arts winner in 1987, and he was totally into sports as a kid. Pitcher in the baseball team, played football. He actually played semi-pro baseball on an all-black semi-professional team for 2 years, but an injury led him to focus 100% on art for the rest of his life. What I wanted to say about Carlos is that he has a doctorate from the University of Michigan, and he said that his wife went the conservatory route when she was studying music classically, but he didn't start formal classical training until he was into college himself. And to that point, he said, I was just doing things by ear, learning things on my own and with my family, who's very musical. Being put into the fire at an early age, forcing myself to learn by ear. That was my ear training. The difference is improvisation. Much like jazz, gospel music can be free. There are overlaps, and I always try to find these in my music. For a while, I was struggling to blend styles together, and there are many composers that do blend gospel, pop, and jazz with Western classical music. Listening and studying helped me tremendously. There are so many sounds and textures that we can use in an orchestra, he said. I think of it as color. It's like painting for me. In addition to being a preacher, my dad was also a painter. Every Saturday, I'd watch him paint, and he took his time with things, different brushes, brush strokes, and colors. Working with an orchestra is similar. I take my time. I try to figure out what colors to create with what orchestrations, different pairings and combinations. An amazing resource, a musical palette. The piece, The Block, is really rhythmic, and it's so fun to rehearse, to line everything up and to be able to be listening across the stage to my colleagues and making sure everything is tightly fitting to get that incredible energy across to the audience. So after we're treated to that exciting opening, we move on to a piece by composer Florence Price. Florence has been featured on several different Anchorage Symphony concerts, her symphony and another work, but this is something new to our stage too. It's called Dances in the Cane Breaks. Now, Florence is evolving to be a hugely significant American composer, being also that she's Black and female are a sideline to the fact that she is a really amazing composer. Many of her compositions focused on the experience of Black Americans, from the period of slavery into the first half of the 20th century. She wrote orchestra, chamber works, and vocal works, and was a child prodigy on the piano and the organ with a passion to compose. And she went to the New England Conservatory at the age of 16. She played for silent films, and she also wrote radio jingles to earn some money when she was still trying to find her way. She got married. Her husband, sadly, was an alcoholic, and she was divorced and had two kids to raise as a single mom. She brought the family to Chicago, which is where she lived the majority of her later years of life. Even the best of her 300 works are rarely heard in concert halls due to racism and misogyny. And that trend is starting to change, and that's good. She wrote Dances in the Canebrakes in 1953, the year she died. And they were originally three piano solos as a suite and were orchestrated by African-American composer himself, William Grant Still. A canebrake is a thicket of tall cane plants similar to bamboo that grows at the edge of a marsh. And in the South, which depended on cotton for its economy, slaves had to clear the cane so that land could be cultivated for cotton. It was very hard work on extremely hot days, and the relief of a cool evening with a little bit of rest and an opportunity to sing and dance was important respite to the workers who had no choice in what they were doing with their lives. Price's dances incorporate the rhythms of ragtime and early ballroom from the period of 1900 on. Think Scott Joplin, especially on the first dance, which is called Nimble Feet. It's a rag, charismatic and cheerful and cheeky. And then the second is Tropical Noon, which is dreamy and sleepy, a slow drag and quite easygoing. And then the final dance, Silk Hat and Walking Cane, which is a cakewalk with a sparkling melody that cascades downward and has a twinkling finish. Florence, we're loving playing this music. To conclude the first half of our January concert, we're performing a work by Samuel Barber, his first symphony. He had the same philosophy as Aaron Copland that it evolved in the mid-1930s. Both of these iconic American composers decided that it was much more important to compose music that would be accessible to real people than it was to do the intellectual or more avant-garde atonal music that many contemporary composers were leaning towards. He said, "My aim is to write good music that will be comprehensible to as many people as possible, instead of music heard only by small, snobbish music societies in large cities." His Adagio for Strings is probably his best known work, and it's provided solace to millions of people over the world at times of crisis and sadness. When he was a boy, he was the child prodigy, and he was the second student, only 14 years old at the time, to enter the door of the just opened, now famous, Curtis Institute. A violinist sneaked in ahead of him, so he didn't get to be the first entry person. In 1935, we'll jump ahead a little bit, he won a Pulitzer Travel Fellowship, as well as the Prix de Rome, which involves a two-year residency in Rome, Italy. The summer before he left, he decided to start a new work, which became the First Symphony, in Maine with fellow student and longtime partner, Giancarlo Menotti. He took a draft of the score to Rome and then got distracted by writing songs. And so he traveled to the French Riviera, where he finished the symphony there. A few critics thought it was a little too dark at the time, but it was pretty popular from its first performance, especially in the United States. He revised it in 1942. The four traditional movements of a classical symphony are all fused into one movement here, rapturously lyrical, intensely dramatic, and lots of vivid orchestration. It's compared to Sibelius, who was also a real fan of using powerful brass and low instruments for colors. And he was very revered in the 1920s and 30s, especially. And there are lots of comparisons to his Seventh Symphony, which also was in one movement. The conductor of the premiere describes Samuel Barber's First Symphony as modern, but serious. And so what a treat to be able to hear this live in our January of darkest times in Alaska as we emerge, hopefully, from a COVID surge. After the intermission, we're going to hear a piece by Aaron Copland that will get your feet tapping. This American icon was a composer, author, lecturer, and mentor to many young composers in America. And again, he wanted music of the people, and this piece really represents that philosophy. He was an avid traveler all his life, and to create this work, what set it up, it was his first trip to Mexico. And what he did was he drove from New York to San Antonio, Texas, with his boyfriend at the time, violinist Arthur Kraft. And then they took a train to Mexico City, where they ended up staying there for 4 months in 1932. And he described the whole thing as grander than I expected. They were up till 5 a.m. some nights going out clubbing. So if you're thinking classical composer and maybe a little stodgy, not the case at all. Think 5 a.m. at a nightclub, and that's Aaron Copland right now. So he went to this club called the El Salon Mexico, which was at the time the most popular club in Mexico. He'd heard about it from a friend and also read about it in a tourist guidebook that he wrote about in a journal. And he said, it was described as a Harlem-type nightclub for the people with a grand Cuban orchestra and three halls, one for the people who dressed your way, one for the people dressed in overalls but shod, meaning wearing shoes, and one for the people who were there to dance barefoot. When I got there, he said, I also found a sign on the wall. Please don't throw lighted cigarette butts on the floor because the ladies don't want to burn their feet. He reflected on his contact with real people, saying the atomic sense one sometimes gets in far off places of suddenly knowing the essence of a people, their humanity and unique charm, weighed on him as he was composing this work. And he said, as I was writing the piece, I relived that it was a place to dance and it smelled of sweat. The spirit of the place, waltzes and foxtrots, tangos, danzons, and more. So 1932 to 1936, El Salon Mexico evolved. And he particularly, he said, enjoyed writing the peasant music sections, which were rhythmically rich. There are also four folk songs that printed music versions of them were references for him as he wrote it. And the sections move seamlessly one to the next dance. The moods range from garish to lusty and sentimental and sensuous. And he said he was a little nervous when he went to the first rehearsal of this piece in 1937 in Mexico, because he had been afraid that the players might react to having a gringo such as himself writing music that explored music of their own country. But when he walked into the room, he said all the players applauded vigorously, and I was totally overwhelmed and charmed and beloved. Our grand finale has to be, of course, Gershwin's Rhapsody in Blue, the most iconic jazz classical music fusion in the repertoire. And this has a great story, of course. Gershwin was playing pool with his brother Ira, who was his lyricist partner on many songs and Broadway shows. And Ira was taking a little break from the game, and he took a copy of the New York Tribune out and read an article that was kind of fascinating, that Paul Whiteman, a jazz band conductor and a former violist with the San Francisco Symphony, who evolved into being just into jazz, was announcing that he was doing a New York concert, which would expand the definition of classical music to include jazz. And he said in the interview in the paper that George Gershwin is writing a jazz concert for this event. Well, this was news to Gershwin, who immediately called Whiteman and said, well, I didn't know about this and I can't do this. But Whiteman convinced him, because he said, one of my competitors jumped the gun. I was going to work with you more on this, but he's doing a concert that might be like it, and I have to be the first. So history was made, and Gershwin would be the soloist for a work that he would write for piano and orchestra, jazz orchestra. He was willing to write the tunes, but unwilling to orchestrate it. And so that's where Ferdi Groffé, later American composer of his own fame, who was at that time the arranger for the Whiteman Band, took on the orchestration. And he had lots of great stories about Gershwin doodling around on his upright piano in his apartment. And he worked on it. It was done about 5 weeks is all it took. A musical kaleidoscope of America, of our unduplicated national pep, said Gershwin, our metropolitan madness. The iconic clarinet opening, well, if you don't know what I'm talking about, you will once you hear a recording or get to attend our live concert. Ira relayed that the title, Rhapsody in Blue, was inspired by art, by an artist, James Abbott Whistler, who had a gallery showing at the time, which included a painting called Whistler's Mother, which isn't called Whistler's Mother. He had named it Arrangement in Gray and Black. And I was really inspired about this idea of using abstracts like colors in terms of titles for art and music. Thus, Rhapsody in Blue, blue being a reference to jazz, the blues, and the rhapsody is the form of the piece, which is one movement which just kind of takes you on a journey, a floodgate of colors, and a stunning melody at the center that some people say Rachmaninoff would have been proud to have written that sentimental, gorgeous melody that's there. At the premiere, it was hilarious reading about it. Paul Whiteman, the conductor, critic noted that he does not conduct. He trembles, wobbles, quivers, a piece of jazz jelly, conducting the orchestra sometimes with the back of his right trouser leg rather than his hand up in the air. Gershwin, of course, was a phenomenal pianist at the opening concert, but he was improvising half the piece because he hadn't had a lot of it written down yet when that evolved after the premiere. And there were lots of interesting people in the audience. I would have loved to have been there. It's a who's who of classical and jazz. Artists like Fritz Kreisler and Yasha Heifetz and Rachmaninoff were attending. Stravinsky and Sousa, the writer of all those wonderful marches we love. And the antics of the players were described. Don't tell anybody in the Angry Symphony about what I'm about to relay. The clarinetist who did the solo at the beginning wore a battered top hat, and he sometimes even played into the hat. Everybody rocking about. They did not play like an army, said one of the critics, but like the mellow maniacs they are, bitten by rhythms that would have twiddled the toes of Saint Anthony. So we look forward to our Anchored Symphony performance to conclude a really amazing evening with this iconic piece with Dr. Timothy Smith at the keyboard. And I know he's going to really wow us all. And a fun fact historically about me is that I played Rhapsody in Blue when I was a senior in high school at East High. And we did the performance at West High because there were going to be hopefully a lot of people coming, and a lot of people did come. And my mom made me a blue velvet dress to wear. So it has a very soft spot in my heart whenever I hear this piece and get to play just a little bit of it. So go, Tim, and we've all got you there, and it's going to be a glorious evening. So that's kind of a quick overview of your January concert experience. And I look forward to introducing you to some fun facts about our February exploration soon. Stay safe and let's keep symphonying on.